chapter 2, verse 1. Y'all going to get excited. Y'all going to think I'm going to preach on Pentecost, and we're all going to shout and holler and speak in tongues, which we might, but that ain't what I'm preaching on. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And I want y'all to say that with me from the word they. They were all with one accord in one place. And the Lord has really been dealing with me on and off about prayer. And today I was thinking about prayer and unity and how those things affect us. And then the Lord began to deal with me on obedience and several other things. And this verse came to mind. And so I don't want to talk about Pentecost. Not that that's bad, but tonight we're going to talk about unity. More precisely, we're going to talk about them being in unity and what it took to get there. I got approached tell me over the years. Start this way. I've had people tell me over the years that they want me to be their pastor. I've had them to tell me that they want to come to church and do what the Lord wants done. And that's cool. I'll take that. I'm thankful for that. I consider that a humbling thing, Brother James. It blesses me. I'm thankful for everybody here. But yet, when the rubber meets the road, there's people that you find that don't live up to their words. And I'm not criticizing, and I'm not talking about anybody necessarily who's not here tonight. That's not my point, because I know there's a lot of legitimate reasons. But I find that when we say those things, our thinking may be in the right spot. Now, if I looked at somebody and said, I want to be in your ministry, but then when it's time for me to be in your ministry and I'm not in it, then that tells me one of two things. Either one, I was completely wrong and didn't need to be in your ministry, or number two, I'm not being obedient to God. And you say, Shawn, where are you going with this? I don't want you to follow me. I don't want you to follow man. I want you to follow God. And when you're telling me or somebody else that you want to be in their ministry, but then you're not following through with it, then that tells me that you're really trying to follow them and never really trying to follow God. And if you think about that for a minute, and I got thinking about those 120 that come to that room, and I want you to think about why they were in that room. I think about the people who come and congregate this congregation on a weekly basis. And very few of the congregants are local people. Brother Scott, they're people who drive a lot of time from another county over. They just Scott and Millie and Brother James and a couple others maybe that are from here, everybody else kind of migrates in. See, that tells me, not that it doesn't for James and the other close ones, but that tells me that when you're coming this far, that you're wanting to be a part of what God's doing and not a part of me, because you ain't going to follow me this far, but you'll follow God this far. And see, we got these people in the upper room, and you begin to ask yourself how they got there, Brother Mason. And you look at them. They were people from Jerusalem. They were people from Galilee. They had been following Jesus. Jesus is dead. Jesus rose from the grave. He said, go wait on me. And so they go and they do what he said to do, and they gather in that upper room. But they become uncomfortable in the process of doing that. You say, how do you know they become uncomfortable? Because we go back and we look at the apostles when Christ is risen, and he come and he found them fishing on their boat, Brother Scott. And Peter was even naked. They had went back to doing what they were comfortable with before. You see, they had went back to what their life had been. Blake, they had went back to fishing. And Christ comes along. And he says, boys, I don't think you're doing real good on that side of the boat. Won't you try on the other? And they said, well, let's try it. And the book of John, I think it is, actually tells how many fish they caught and their nets was breaking and they had to get it back. And then he asks Peter that question. Of course, Peter had then got embarrassed and dove in the water and got his clothes back on. And so then they come to the shore. And the Lord's done got supper fixed. And he sits down with Peter and he says, Peter, do you love me? Lord, help me, Jesus. I love you. He said, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, well, you know I do, Lord. He said, feed my lambs. I like that first part of that because he said, feed my lambs. The other two times he says, feed my sheep. Isn't that funny that he notated between lambs and sheep? What's the difference? Well, not a lot at the end of the day, but if he's feeding lambs and he's feeding sheep, he's not just feeding the old ones or the grown ones, he's feeding the young ones too. He's feeding them all. He says, feed my lambs. And then he said, you know, and no doubt Peter thought, okay, Lord, I'll feed your lambs. And then the Lord says to him, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, well, yeah. You know I do. He said, feed my sheep. Peter's like, all right. Y'all ever get that? It's like a bad knock-knock joke. You know what I'm saying? It just keeps going and you kind of bang your head like make it stop. My children, you know, I know they get tired of me. They'll come out of one room and I'll say, what room are you in? Which is indication of. And they'll say, well, it's the kitchen. It's like, well, your bedroom light's on. Why, you know, if you're in here, why's your bedroom light on? And so now I don't even have to finish the conversation. I'm just like, what room are you in? You know, and they go back and they turn their light off. No doubt Peter was feeling that kind of frustration when the Lord said, do you love me? He's like, well, yeah, I love you. Do you love me? Well, yeah, we just went through this. I just told you I did. And he asked him the third time, and he said it grieved Peter. And he's like, you know I do, Lord. And he said, feed my sheep. And so then we find what Peter does with the other 119. And he makes himself uncomfortable and he goes and he gets in the upper room. See, we tell God all the time that, Lord, I'll do what you want me to do. But when push comes to shove, Sister Sheila, we won't live up to our end of the obligation. That 120 didn't get in that upper room because it was easy. That 120 didn't get in that upper room, Sister Kathy, because it was convenient. They didn't get in that upper room because they was not willing to do what God wanted them to do. But they got in that upper room because that's what the Lord told them to do. It didn't matter that it may have been the hot part of weather. It didn't matter that they didn't have air conditioner. It didn't matter that they left their friends and family behind. It didn't matter that they had to travel to another city in order to get this accomplished. They were willing to do whatever it took to accomplish the will of God. And that is the reason, it says, that they were in one accord. Because of that willingness they had in their heart to obey God. The question for us is, are we willing? I like what Henry Blackaby said about it. He said, the question is not, Lord, what is your will for my life? But Lord, what is your will? And I will adjust my life to it. You see, we miss it so much, man. We miss it so much, Mason. We're like, you know, I'd like to do that. But man, I tell you, I can't get over there. I can't do that. I can't do this. I'd like to teach Sunday school, but it starts too early in the morning. I'd like to go minister in the prisons, but... you know, I can't do that on that day or this day. You know, I'd like to go to church over yonder, but this and this gets in my way and blah, 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 blah. What are we willing to sacrifice for? What are we willing to fight for? You know, and you say, Sean, this is kind of an odd message. You know, and I know it's a little bit of an odd message, but it's to really call our hearts into the open about our willingness to be obedient to God, my own included. If he called me to go to Africa right now, would I drop everything and go? I mean, you know, it's a valid question, Brother Scott. Am I content fishing on my boat doing what I know to do? Or am I willing to become uncomfortable for God, Brother James? Am I willing to go to the upper room and be in one accord? Am I willing to be in agreement with the Father? I like what Jesus said two different occasions. On the first one, he said, they said, hey, your mom and your sisters and your brothers on the outside of the crowd, they want to see you. And he said, who is my mother and my sister and my brothers but them that do the will of my Father? That's a paraphrase. The other time he said, unless you hate your mother and your father and your brother and your sisters, you can have no part in me. Now we know contextually that he didn't mean for us to hate our families, but he meant exactly what he said in the third place when the young man said, I want to follow you, but let me go bury my daddy. And he said, well, let the dead bury their dead. In other words, there comes a point in time when I must choose God over my family. I've got obligations as a father. That does not excuse me from those obligations. I am obligated by the Word of God to take care of my family first. So don't take me out of context. But you know, people come up with all kinds of excuses. Well, I can't do it because of this, and I can't do it because of that. That has nothing to do with anybody not being here on Sunday. This is a much broader picture than being here on Sunday night. You know, worshiping God, we might do it in a collective group on Sunday, but that is not your whole walk with God. Your whole walk with God is what you do 7 days a week. I'm supposed to be working for God and worshiping God every day that I walk. This just happens to be when we get together as a group and worship God and talk about how good He is and learn from His Word. The other 6 days, man, I'm on the beat doing the job. So it ain't about whether you make it over here on Sunday. It's not about whether you make it anywhere else through the week. It's about where your heart is with God, and are you willing to become uncomfortable? Are you willing to get in that upper room? You know, it could have been real easy for one of them to say, well, I tell you what, man, I like to get in on that up there. That might have been a reason why there wasn't 121. You know, you ever think maybe 120 wasn't a magic number? Maybe that was just the only people he found willing to get in that upper room? Maybe there was another 45 downstairs kind of walking around, scratching their head like, you know, I like going up there, but I heard there's only standing room only. And you know what, man, it's hot in that room. You know what time of day it is. That sun's coming out. Man, it's going to get hot up in there. And you know the people are going to be stinking. I don't want to be in there in that room. They didn't have deodorant back then, in case you didn't know. They probably didn't bath every day. You know? You ever think that there might have been a whole bunch of people that had the opportunity to be in the upper room, but they chose not to be in the upper room? Have you ever wondered why you see some people who seem to excel at serving God and their ministries can't be daunted and they seem to thrive? We were talking about Brother Tackett a while ago, and almost every Sunday, Brother Brent posted on Facebook that they've had somebody else saved in their church. And I'm like, man, that is so awesome. My heart just aches for something like that. And you think, man, what's Brent got that the rest of us don't? And I'm going to tell you something. I don't know that Brent's got anything that we don't, other than maybe his heart's in the right spot. And he's trying to be obedient to God. He's willing to get in the upper room. He's willing to do what it takes. He's willing to make himself uncomfortable. And you know, we look at that 120, and there they are in unity, in one mind and one accord. And we've seen what happened. 3,000 souls got added to the kingdom. And we ask ourselves, what are we doing for the kingdom? I want to be part of this. Well, then be part of it. I want to be part of that. I'll be part of it. There's nothing stopping you but you. You see what I'm saying? I'm not fussing. I'm not. I'm talking about myself. Because I get really anxious about things. I get tore up, man. But then I think about that right there, and I'm like, God, what do you want me to do? And He says, like Black, if he says it, I'll say it that way. He'll say, well, you see where I'm working, and you adjust yourself to it. When I see God working, Brother Kyle, that's my invitation to adjust myself to God. You know, when I see Brother Scott with a flat on the side of the road, I don't have to ask God if I need to help him with his flat. I need to stop and help Scott with his flat. If somebody's dying in the hospital, I know they're dying in the hospital, and they need Jesus, I don't have to ask God if I need to go pray for that person. That's generally my invitation to go pray for that person. You say, but I'm going to have to drive to Ashland. I reckon your trip to Ashland is minor in the face of eternity. Right? I reckon that if you're really supposed to go down there, the Lord said, don't worry about what you're going to eat and drink, what you're going to wear. We got all that covered. I'll take care of it. Just be obedient to it. Peter and Andrew and James and John left behind, we could argue, successful businesses. They were businessmen. In essence, that's what they'd done. They fished. People bought their fish. They were businessmen. They left behind successful businesses to serve God. Matthew, the publican, a tax collector, left behind a good paying job to serve God. Maybe not as reputable as the other businessmen in the group, but, you know, a good paying job.
I don't know if Peter was on public name speed.
Well, I know, right? Maybe it didn't pay as much as we think. But they left behind these things. You say, did they have families? We know Peter did. Because Christ healed Peter's mother-in-law. So we at least know Peter was married out a bunch. Most people got married. It wasn't the thing for them to be stag at that point in time. And so, you know, what did they do? Well, we know at some point they had to compromise what they had in the world to serve God. They lived in Galilee. And they went to Jerusalem to hang out in a room with a bunch of hot, sweaty people. They were willing to do whatever it took to accomplish the will of God. Brother Scott.
Sounds like you're talking about the early roots of the Pentecostal movement. A lot of what you said rang bells with what I know about Azusa Street and in Carolinas. I don't know exactly where that is. You know, they were seeking God. They weren't seeking a leader, an earthly leader, but seeking God.
Amen. Azusa Street started, for lack of a better definition, in a black church there on Azusa Street. And they said the pastor would actually come in and would stick his head in a crate or a box and get down on his knees. My understanding is, now I could be wrong, so don't quote me 110%. He would get down on his knees and bury his head in a box and he would start praying. And the congregation would follow. And I guess the Spirit moved on them, and that's when Pentecostal broke out there in Azusa Street, and that particular movement of which outsprang the Assemblies of God spread in a lot of parts of this nation. And, of course, inside that church service, there was a lot of speaking in tongues going on, and there was a little pastor down on his knees at some point in time during this, and with his head stuck in his box. And some old feller stood up in the middle of the congregation and decided to rebuke him because he thought that was out of order. And I guess that old feller pulled his head out of the box and pointed at him and spoke in tongues. And the old feller sat back down, he stuck his head in the box and went right on praying. They were not after an earthly thing. They were after a heavenly thing. The people who started the Church of God, which was in part the Pentecostal movement that broke on this end of the country, the people who were seeking that, they began to seek the idea of wholeness and clean living more than what they had seen in the other denominations. And they begin to seek a blessing from God, a movement of the Spirit, and they started meeting in a schoolhouse. And the other denominations got so mad at what they were doing, they tore the schoolhouse down. So they couldn't meet in it anymore. But they didn't stop them. They went right on doing what needed to be done. The apostles got arrested, and they took them before the Sanhedrin court. And they said, don't preach about Jesus anymore. And one of them said, had you rather we obey man or God? See, that's the problem, is we want to obey man or the world or our money. He said, you can't serve both God and mammon. He said, you can't have two masters because you'll love one and hate the other, or cling to one and despise the other. See, that's the problem. We won't choose God over the world. We won't get uncomfortable. We won't sacrifice. We won't give until it hurts. We won't pray and tear our knees callous over. We won't read until our eyes cross. We won't read until the pages fall out of our Bible. If they do, it's only because we fell asleep when we read three verses and accidentally ripped it out. It ain't got nothing to do with us wearing it out. The most war pages in my Bible are the ones over in James, because I taught a big section of James for I don't know how long at Garrick in adult Sunday school, and I stayed on the pages forever during that. The other section is in the book of Acts, and it's the verses I read when I baptize people most of the time. And it's because I'm there a lot. I mean, not to baptize, it just had to be a place I frequent. So that's the war pages in my Bible. Why ain't the war pages in my Bible the words written in red? Why ain't the war pages in my Bible starting at Genesis and all the way to the book of Revelation? Why do I have pajamas that still got knees in them? Why do I have pants that still has knees in them? Why aren't I wearing them out on the floor praying and seeking after the will of God? He said, well, they got immunity. They wanted something. They didn't just want something. I could holler pizza, and most of us would be in unity that we wanted pizza. We'd all be like, hey, man, that's good. Let's get some pizza. They wasn't after something. They wasn't after just something, Brother James. Brother Kyle, they were after something particular. You said, what were they after, Sean? They were after whatever God wanted. You say, they were there to get the comforter. I'm going to be honest with you. They may have had an idea the comforter was coming, because we know it says that, but they didn't know what was coming.
As I understand it, you check me. I was taught that they knew, they come out of the traditional churches knowing that there was more. They knew in their spirit there was more. And they got together to seek for that. Whether they totally understood
what they were
what was coming at them out of that obedience is another issue. They knew there was more than what they were experiencing in their spirit.
That's exactly right, Brother Scott. And that's a wonderful addition to this particular topic. You think about that. They knew that they were more, that there was more. The people in the upper room knew, Mason, that there was something coming. And they knew there was more. And they were willing, Blake, to do whatever it took. I preached several Sundays ago about I need more of God, and how that when my heart was turned that direction, that the only thing I begged for was more of God, that things seemed so much easier and simpler, and we would see God move more, you know, and somewhere years down the road, that was years back, things changed in the way that I begin to think, and I you know, not anything bad, not that I don't want more of God, but I find that I like to control things, and you know, if I really just humble myself, and I just cry out for more of God, and I'm willing to get His will done. If I put my clothes on and get off my fishing boat and get at the feet of Jesus, if I'll get in the upper room. But here's the thing about us as individuals and us as a church. First of all, me as an individual, I have to be willing. I have to be willing. If I'm not willing, it will not work. I don't care if the other 119 get blessed, if I'm not there, then I'm not going to get blessed. If I'm not there mentally, if I'm not there emotionally, or I'm not there physically, then I ain't going to get blessed. Can you say amen? Amen. Can't do it. So me as an individual, I got to be there. I got to be willing. Do you reckon out of that 120, do you reckon there was any of them that went, you want me to do what? You with me? You reckon there's any of them thought that? Like the Lord's like, go get in that upper room, wait on the comforter. What? There's going to be a bunch up there. Go wait on them. Huh? You want me to go to Jerusalem to the random room and sit and wait? I mean, you reckon? You reckon there's anybody done that? We do that to God all the time. You know? Brother Robert Gross. Love Brother Robert Gross. Guy who went to church with Bogart. Told me a testimony one time, and he was... I forget the particular kind of job he was doing at that time. Maybe it was contracting work, but he was out working. And the Lord told him to go to somebody's house and pray for him. He said, I got a word for him. And so he went, prayed for that person. The Lord had a word for him, and he left. A few days later, a couple weeks later, whatever, the Lord told him to go to somebody else's house. Pray for him. So he did, Brother Mason. And the Lord had a word for him. It was good, man. And people was like, oh, man, that was God doing, Brother Robert feeling high. You know, and that really kind of suited him because he used to lift weights. He's kind of a big guy, you know. So that kind of, he was a big guy, wasn't he, man? And the Lord told him to go to such and such's house and pray for him that he wanted to heal him. And he said, but Lord, they're in a wheelchair. He said, Lord, they're in a wheelchair. He said, I don't know. And he didn't go. Had to repent for it. Person, I guess, as far as I know, I think they were dead by the time he told me, so I guess they died in the wheelchair. Missed the opportunity. Robert says, I know if I would have went, that the Lord would have healed that person. But because of her own doubt and her own unbelief, because in some cases our own unwillingness to adjust to God, we miss the opportunities God has for us. We miss the chance that we have to become more for God. Say, Shawn, what do you want? I just want God's will. He said, well, Shawn, did you want to be congregation? Sure, yeah, whatever. I just want God's will. Don't you want a big mega church? Well, I'll be honest, no, I don't. I don't. You can keep your church buildings. I don't need a church building. I better be careful, hey. I get myself in trouble. You know what I mean, Lord. I'm thankful for this beautiful building. I really am. But I'm not after a big mega church. I don't get me wrong. I'll take anybody the Lord sends to me in any number, I reckon. I'd take them all. But that's not my goal. My goal is to be in obedience to the Father. My goal is to be willing. My goal is to want whatever God wants. And to be in unison, to be in one accord in that upper room, that don't mean I'm after my own desires. That means I'm after the desires of God. I love it. People misquote that verse all the time. It says, the Bible says He'll give you the desires of your heart. Prosperity garbage. Prosperity garbage. I detest prosperity preaching as a general rule. Don't get me wrong. I do firmly believe you can't outgive God. I do firmly believe He'll take care of you. I do believe some people are blessed financially and some of us ain't for whatever reason. And that's just it. But they want to take that verse. I got to chase a rabbit for like 30 seconds. They want to take that verse and they want to use that verse like the Lord's going to supply you as some kind of materialistic ideology of you getting what you want out of the world. No! That ain't how that works. Let me tell you something. The desires of my heart ought to be in alignment with the desires of my Father's heart. Amen? We could look at it in a much more cynical way and say, yeah, He'll keep the desires of your heart. If you want to be greedy and rich, He'll let you be greedy and rich. He said some of them gets it down here and some of them gets it over yonder. But He wasn't meaning for me to have material things, Brother James. He was meaning for me to have the will of God. Yes.
Come across the interest. Praise all of you. The grass is always greener on every side of the fence. The other side of the fence is usually good before.
That's exactly right. And that's usually a lot of truth. We see a lot of prosperity preaching, and there's no truth to it, Brother James. No truth at all. And the desires of my heart should be after my own gain. You say, Shawn, why'd you come? Just use me as an example. Not because I'm good. You say, why'd you come by this? Because God sent me here. What do you want to accomplish here? God's will. I don't get me wrong. Now, my flesh wears up on some days. Yeah, I'd like to see them packed out the door. People running, shouting, hollering, and screaming. Whatever. Take it if it gets here. Be thankful for it if it does. But I want God's will, Brother James. And I know what's been happening the last 2 months in this church. And Sunday after Sunday, there's been one person or another, if not multiple, that have come here and eat from the master's table when they need to eat. 6 or 7 people, 12 or 20. But every Sunday we've seen them. They come in need. They get fed from the Spirit like the sister needs.
Well, that's like this is the first Sunday. This is the second Sunday I've had off since the last time I was here.
Which have been months.
Months. Back up to December, I believe.
Getting pretty close.
The end of November, beginning of December.
Yeah. Yeah.
I got that new job. I don't come Sundays, but I don't want to go 11 o'clock at night. I don't have to leave. I need to still be in.
Right. That's right. So you're able to be here. And, you know, it... People's like, well, man, it's not half chance you all are here. It's not half chance at all. There's a purpose for all of us being here. Even the messages, as small as they maybe be that we preach to you sometimes, there's a purpose in our heart. And tonight's purpose is to call into question. Are you willing to go to the upper room? Are you willing to become uncomfortable? Are you willing to be in unison with God's people? Now, let me talk about a broader sense of that for just a moment, and I think I'm about done. I got a little tangent the other day, and I joked Kyle, and I said, I might even have to pull that out of the message, because I got a little personal thing that I kind of griped about. And now listen, I like to shout as much as about any human I ever met. Blake can attest to that. I get me in the right environment, and I shout a lot, don't I, Brother Blake? But I don't need to recreate Pentecost. It already happened. It's still here. It didn't go nowhere. That fire is just as available now as it was 2,000 years ago when they got in one accord in the upper room. They were not there seeking Pentecost as we know it because they didn't know what was coming. The Lord didn't tell them. The only thing they knew is that somebody said he was going to baptize them in fire. He said, I'm going to send a comforter. Going to tell you all truth. He never said that they speak in tongues. They didn't know what was going to come to this God. He didn't say he's going to act like drunk people. He didn't say he's going to shout all over the place. He didn't say there's going to be a big revival and 3,000 people get saved. They just knew that being in that upper room where God told them to be was a broader purpose in God's plan. They didn't know the outcome. And to be honest with you, they probably didn't care what the outcome was. Their goal was to be in the center of the will of God. And they were content with that. They were content to know that that's what Christ had told them to do. They were content with that, Brother James. He said, wait on me in that room. Comforter's coming. They're like, gotcha, brother. On the way. And they all go up and they all sit down. What do you reckon they done? You reckon they prayed? Didn't say they prayed. You reckon they eat? Didn't say they eat. Didn't say they've been fasting that I know of. Just said they were in one accord. They were up there with one purpose in mind, and that was to be obedient to the Father. That was to be in the center of God's will. And see, we talk about being in one accord with one another, but sometimes we don't understand what that means. But that means in this case that we all have the same purpose in mind, and that is to be in the center of God's will, and that is to further the kingdom of God. And that is simply this, that I need and want more of God. When we get to the point where we all are in agreement with one another about what it is that we want, and what it is that we want is what God wants, which is more of Him, and to be in His will, then we can see God move, not only in our own lives, but as a congregation. And you say, well, Sean, does that mean sometimes I have to go somewhere I don't want to go? Probably. Yes, most likely. Does that mean that times are going to get hard for me? Maybe so. Sure. I know of a couple missionaries that they've done their best to stay in the center of God's will and wound up living in a barn. They didn't mind. Pretty content with it overall. Until the fleas got real bad. It was sketchy. But they've done their best for it, right? Stay in the center of the will of God. And that's all they cared about. And you said, what happened to them now? They're on another equestrian ranch down in Florida. Got a church in Ecuador that seems to be thriving. They got a broader picture of it. They didn't care about material things. They just want God's will now. Just like those people in the upper room. The one accord that we need to have as individuals is to want God's will. Not for our life. No. To want God's will for your life means that God is evolving the whole thing around you. Who am I out of 7 billion people that the whole thing's going to evolve around me? It don't evolve around me. It evolves around Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So why in the world would I want God to adjust to me and my wants? Makes no sense. Look at it for a minute. Think about that for half a minute. What I want that? No. We got to get willing to go to the upper room to be in unity. We got to get willing to say, okay, God, where are you working? And I will adjust myself to it. Say, Sean, does it work that way? Yeah, it does. I can prove it by the Bible. I can prove it in my own life. I said, prove it by the Bible. Jesus said, come on. They said, let's go. Simple. There it is. He said, I'm going to make you fishers of men. Did he tell them he's going to have churches?
No.
Did he tell them what's going to happen to them? No. They said, come on, we're going to make you fishers of men. They said, okay, here we go. That's your will, Lord. We're on it. He told Moses, says, hey, going to go get the people out of Egypt. Want to help me? I need a mouthpiece. Calling you to go. Moses had an option. Moses could have said, I don't know, Lord. Which he kind of did. Got in trouble about his public speaking problems. But anyways, got Aaron attached to him. But he had the option not to go. But he said, all right, Lord, if that's what you're doing, that's what I'm going to do. Did he get in trouble? Had all kinds of problems. But he stayed in the center of the wilderness. Amen? The Lord drove me to a youth group. I was working at 8 o'clock on Friday night. Me and Missy talked about it. We really felt to get involved with the youth. Gary. I told Pastor Bill, I said, Bill, I'm changing my work schedule. That way I can be at youth on Friday night. I said, I'm going to be there Friday night. I'm closing down at 5 o'clock or 6. I don't remember what I said at that time. I said, we're closing down. That way I can be there by 6 or 7 o'clock. I think it's going to start. I said, that way I can be there. I didn't ask for a class. That was not my goal. I didn't ask to be the youth leader. That was not my goal. I just knew that God wanted me there, and I knew that that's what He was, and so I adjusted my life. He said, well, did you open more hours on another day? Nope. Did your business lose money? Nope. And if it did, didn't matter, because God will provide. I knew that everything else was secondary to me and Missy being there on Friday nights. Within 2 weeks, we were made youth leaders. And we were like, we went into a meeting. We hadn't even made it the first Friday night. I changed my schedule. And the week I changed my schedule, I think it was, or a week after I changed my schedule, Bill had a meeting. He didn't even ask me. The pastor, for those of you listening who don't know who Bill is, he was a pastor. And me and Missy go into this meeting, and there's the old youth leaders, and me and Missy, and the other people who were supposed to be there who wanted to be involved with the youth. And he said, I'm making Shawn and Missy the youth leaders. And I'm like, do what? But I seen where God was working, Brother Mason, and I adjusted myself to it. I said, okay, God, if that's what you want, that's what I'm doing. And you know what? The strangest thing occurred. There's a lot of the people who said they wanted to do it didn't hang on. Huh? Gee, that's what got us on this little tirade in the first place. You know why? Because they wasn't after the will of God. They were scratching their own itches. Oh, gee, man, when people hear that, they're getting all kinds of problems. Might be a good thing more people don't listen to them. But it's the truth. I'll give you another example, and I really will try to touch. I'll give you two. First of all, the Lord said, Brother Paul called me and said, you want to go to Inez? And pastor, and I'm like, I don't know. I've got no inkling to leave Gary, Brother Paul. I said, but me and Missy will pray about it. It was almost the words I told him. I don't think I laughed, but I thought to myself, whatever, man. Hey. You know, and the Lord said, go, and I'm like, really? Okay. Here we are. You know, did I do it? I come over here with nothing. I mean, as an example, we come over here, Sister Diane was the only person left in the church. Okay? I joked somebody the other day, I said, they give me a Missy a fixer-upper. We're over fixing the mess that somebody else caused. I can't do it. It's God and our obedience. It's not us. I'm just trying to be obedient to God. But I didn't come here. I don't get no money out of this. I didn't come here for the money. I don't care. You know, it's a 40-minute drive. I didn't come here because it was convenient. You see what I'm saying? I'm not trying to make myself on a pedestal, but I'm making a point out of our life that I'm not obedient to God when it's convenient to me. I'm obedient to God because He's God, and it's what I need to be done. Last example. There had been some problems at Garrett a while back. And those problems has caused a lot of problems. And 6 months before the problems come, the Lord started saying, don't leave Gary. I had like 5 different people tell me not to leave Gary. Or 5 different ways. I forget how it all come about. And I'm like, all right, Lord. Okay, Lord, I hadn't intended to leave Garrett anyways. All right, fine. Okay, don't know why you're telling me this. Know there's problems coming, but okay, Lord, I won't leave Garrett. And you know what? Still, when the problems come, Brother Mason, I almost left Garrett. You know how people get. Don't do it my way, hurt my feelings, blah, blah, blah. It's true. Pride is all it is. Still had to tell me 6 months before it happened, Sister Kathy, not to leave. And I still almost left. But you know why I stayed? Point of example, not point because I'm good, because I am a flawed, ugly little human. But I stayed out of obedience. Why? Because I wanted God's will more than I wanted my own will. You say, well, how did it benefit you? Well, one, I walked into the pastorship of a church that the Lord led me to. Number two, it allowed me to part ways with that other ministry with no hard feelings. How many times do you ever hear that happen? And not only is there no hard feelings, the other pastor comes and blesses me and helps me here. Amen? I want God's will more than I want anything else. I want God's will more than I want anything else. Can you say amen? I want to be in that upper room, Brother James, not because that I know the Holy Ghost is going to fall, but I want to be in that upper room with a bunch of people who just want God's will done. And we're satisfied with that. If he says go on the streets, I want to go preach. If he wants me to pray for somebody in the middle of the store, I want to go pray for somebody. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I just want to live it all the time. All the time. I just want to live it. I just want to be in unison. I want to be in one accord. And I want everybody to be in one accord with the Lord, not with me, because I'm a little screwed up and I may not always be right, but I want you to be in one accord with God. And if you're in one accord with God and I'm in one accord with God, then guess what? We're all in one accord with each other. I'm not the focal point. You might have put me here to keep people in the grass, but I'm not the focal point. He is. Give God some glory. Amen.